out.
Well, let's see.
As you find from the last time, my voice goes up and down, and I'm a bit throaty today. So, nice to see so many familiar faces. Yeah, thank you for having me back. I've done a little bit of a slideshow here, partly just so you can get an idea of what the platform is when you hear about IBM's analytics platform. But it covers all the bits and pieces about why we have taken different approaches in how we package things up. Run through those quickly, and then go on to some of the services that have been made available in the last month on Bluemix, that gives you access to more stuff, either in the Watson Cognitive platform, the unstructured analytics, as well as the more structured analytics. And I'd like to introduce you to the Watson Analytics Big Data University course, which is a quick thing you can do on site, so I'll show you that. And it takes you through the Watson Analytics Insights, the personal edition, and the personal and pro editions of the Watson Analytics tools. So they're more about structured data, but I'll show you some of the stuff that we can do with those Twitter data feeds that we talked about last time, and also what we have in the pipeline for the fact that we've now acquired the weather company and all the weather data that can come in. Now, so if you get bored, stick your hands up and say, oh, we know this, we've seen it. I know there are a number of repetitive slides here, but I'll go through them quickly. See if you can spot them. So the whole idea of this is big data and large-scale pervasive analytics is based on the assumption that if we only knew all the data that there was available to us, we could solve pretty much any problem, but we're walking past it. The data is just going past, we'll never see it. So we can't solve problems that we don't have any information on. Backwards and forwards, and looking at the screen as well. Yes. Okay. Vast majority of people want to have access to the information where they are, not on a laptop, on a desktop. It's whichever device they're using have handy to them is to be able to consume some kind of data, and they want it to be better than what you would have with commercially available analytics tools or some kind of presentation services. But the experience of having the data is going to be really valuable to you immediately. Yeah. And that's kind of drives the trend for where most companies are addressing large scale analytics. But we want to have it from where you are and where the data's come from and how that relates to where you are at any given time. And we're also looking for time specific data. So we can tell you information about what happened on a bulk retrospective view of data traditionally, what we call a kind of business insights model or performance reporting. But it wouldn't give you an idea of what was happening to a particular thing or a particular area at a particular time. And it's the time and space context that can help give you a lot more insight. Everything we're doing is trying to bring all of those things together and make it possible to do temporal reasoning, geospatial reasoning around large-scale data. The most pervasive one you'll have seen, hopefully over the last, remember the last time I was here, was the Rugby World Cup. You'll have seen every rugby player in all professional sports now, but particularly in rugby, has a tag on their back, so they can be tracked where they are on the field at any given time, what the plays are. They can basically replay the whole game from a tactical and a strategic perspective. What we're now doing is looking to embed fibers into the clothing so that you can tell how much effort is being spent, how hot the body is in particular parts of the body, so you know which muscles are being used, which ones aren't, where to focus on training for the training and actual workouts for the next match. clearly is a car. So there's lots of these kind of, what do you think this is? This is a car, but it's actually a power source. Fuel cell vehicles have the ability to generate way more than you can actually use as a vehicle. So could you use this, the fuel cell excess production capability, to power your house? If you had lots of these vehicles all with the fuel cell capability, what could you do to predict the actual demand on the infrastructure for power distribution, power generation, and be able to offset that? Determine where peak load is. You know that most of the people driving in peak traffic times, so you're not going to get any generation from them. But when they're at home or when they're at work, now you can be tapping off that fuel. What's it? It's lots of different things, but it's, you can be playing music with it, you can be scheduling appointments, you can be using it for managing your appliances, you can manage the heating in your home, those kinds of things. More capability. I was talking to someone a couple of weeks ago who was looking at linking up with white sticks for visually impaired people. So visually impaired people like to have a white stick so they can walk around, and so that everybody knows that they can't. There's a kind of trigger that tells you that they're coming towards you, they can't see properly. That white stick is a warning to other people as well. They're looking at tying in a watch and a phone so that, and a little camera, so you can start to recognize who's coming towards you and give you a warning as the user, that it might be an acquaintance, a friend, a police officer, a shop assistant, who can give you some information, and you know how to start interacting with them. And that's becoming more and more capable through devices like this. You know what it is, but when you start tying that into something like a Watson healthcare system, where the data that you can provide from just where you are, what you're doing, what your activities are, what your schedules are, and Watson can be providing a number of healthcare recommendations to you. And you can also tell it a lot of information directly from where you are. The last time we mentioned this was the ethics side of big data collection. All of that information is being collected on your phone anyway. Some people are getting it. Some of them are getting it. You didn't know it was going on. More and more of that's coming out. But the option here is, could you take this information as an insurance company and start saying to the bearer of a mobile phone, I know where you're going. Really, you shouldn't be going to the pub now. You should be heading to the gym. And if you do that, we might be able to reduce your life insurance. But they might also say the other way around, saying you've already set your life insurance fees. Currently, no. If you go to the pub, we're going to start pushing them up. So the capabilities of big data analytics are nice. The ethics are what it's going to come out with. If everybody can do it, what would you take the impression? Did anybody hear the Radio 4 program last night about the dictatorship of data?
Heard a bit of it.
Yeah. It was a bit rambly, but it was around the technologies for doing just this kind of thing. Means that totalitarian states now have the ability to track where you are, who you're talking to. A little bit of extra code going onto your phone means that all of that encryption that is everybody's worried about between things like WhatsApp messaging platforms, you can get a device that actually captures what's happening as the user sees it, and it doesn't matter whether it's being encrypted or not. So there's a kind of cyber warfare going on to capture just exactly this kind of big data that's very personal. Here's a standard IBM slide that gives you lots of things about solving problems, how you can use the data in lots of different ways. I'm not going to dwell on these because I'm going to skip through these, but I'll send them all as a composite deck to Richard, and you can use them as you like. The bit that we're looking for here is, we've got all the data. We want to put it into the cloud. If it's in the cloud, yeah. it's in the cloud, then we can do lots of analysis, lots of aggregation of data, looking for needles in haystacks. And we've got all the data, we can create a haystack to look for norms and use the norms to identify outliers and anomalous activities, anomalous threads of data moving through the system. So lots of compute power capable on the cloud, which you couldn't do before. You had to rely on your own server infrastructure, your own investments to be able to do this. Now you can use the cloud platform to do it. And the engagement aspect of it is making the data appropriate and delivering it to people in a way that they can use it immediately. So if it's something that you want to be able to do on your watch, if you need it to be on the back of your front door before you head off in the morning to catch the bus, go for a walk, ride your bike, whichever mode of transport you want to do, things like knowing how the weather for the storm that came through yesterday and today, how that's going to affect not the Midlands or the North, but how it's going to affect the journey between where you came from and coming here today, and what's going to be like going back again. That kind of information, very personal, very personal to you at a particular time. So all we're looking at is the engagement side, is how do we get that information to the right people with the use cases for that. You'll see this not only with IBM, but with pretty much any vendor who's talking about big data. It's about the competitive advantage. The more you know, the more you can know, the more you can make decisions. So you can make predictive models based on large corpus of data. You can revisit that model, make sure that any changes that you've implemented based on the model are reflected in the new data. And if it isn't, then you readjust and so on. So you'll have seen some kind of statistical modeling, hopefully, through your courses around things like SPSS, R, where you're looking into analytical models and doing predictive change. So everybody's talking about the more data you can get, the more competitive advantage you have over all of your market players. We're all trying to do it, and the idea is if you don't have a strategy and you don't have a way of implementing it as a business or any kind of player in any market, whether it's a commercial market or not, if you don't have a way of addressing data and analyzing that data appropriately, you're going to fall behind. Some stats here about the paybacks and why it's an advantage to do it. If you don't do it, you will fall behind, you will be disadvantaged. Here's a whole bunch of slides that all look very similar, but they're all in the deck that you get. But it's what do you do with, what can analytics do that can change the way you go to market from addressing market segments or audiences into individuals? Banking, you're talking about based on getting data in, basically bringing money in to turn it into a model where you're looking at what's the outcome that's best for the bank and the customer. If you're looking at government, is responding to needs. You go off and you survey, you then work out what your strategy should be, you come up with a tactical plan, you implement it, things have moved on. The alternative is you now take the data that's coming through as you're implementing things and you anticipate what changes in needs are going to be and you can address those better. And you can also optimize. Healthcare. Alarming, as in, we've found a problem. What do we do about it? As opposed to, we can do proactive interventions. We know that things can go wrong, we can fix them. So you'll see, there's a few more. I'll take the same sort of vein. Insurance is one of the biggest ones that's using big data, that I've talked about before, user-based insurance. Which, as students, you'll probably find quite topical.
It changes the fundamental ethics of insurance from sharing, spreading the risk across the whole population to very, very targeted individual risk, which is much more different.
Targeted risk and adjustable and real-time adjustable. So things like driver insurance is based on the average for age, gender, kind of vehicle, color of vehicle, and your postcode, and whether you park it on street or off street is the traditional model. And adjusted by whether you've been caught speeding or you have any other kind of convictions. The model is moving rapidly towards real-time driver behavior. So you start off with a high premium, which you can then lower by modifying your behavior to be consistent with what the insurance company thinks is lower risk. The lower risk, the less you pay. But the default is that you pay a relatively high mean insurance payments, premiums, and it can come down. But the spread shared risk is covered by, if you don't want to buy in, you're still going to pay for that, everybody else's. You can model yourself to be better. If everybody does it, then the insurance companies will go out of business. But clearly, they don't necessarily want that. Again, it's down to this, the ethics and the application. Retail was the other big thing, is the idea that at any given time, if a retailer knows how you spend, what you spend, where you spend it, and when you have been spending that to consume, you're buying stuff, whether that's food or luxury items, as in things you don't necessarily need but you want, and you can afford to buy them in some way, then they're not just looking at what did you buy, but now what could you buy right now where you are, and then offer you what we call the offer at the time, and predict how you would respond to that offer, and then do a thing called the next best action, which is if you respond, that's great, we'll have to remember that was a good thing. If you don't respond, then maybe we offer you a different thing. Maybe we offer it to you later. But always looking for an opportunity to give you a sale which is supposedly good for you and good for them at the time. It's always going to be good for a retailer to sell you something. It's just not always obvious as to why you might want to buy it. There's also changes coming in here around things like buyer behavior, using large-scale data to work out when you offer people like ASOS, who do things like free returns. You order online, the things you don't like or the things you don't fit, you send back and it costs you nothing. And you'll see that over the next 2 or 3 months, retailers will be offering all kinds of incentives for you to buy things. Even though it doesn't fit you, it's not going to work for you, and they know you're going to return it in January. They would rather sell it to you now and count it before the end of the year as part of the retail boom around Christmas than have you not buy it because it would never fit you anyway. There are companies now working on the idea of getting a relationship to you as an individual and changing the risk around the return to optimize that transaction. Make it very, very personal, and saying if you're in a particular area, or you have a particular buying history, you can't have this sent to your house. You have to go and collect it in store. You can still have all the 5 different sizes and different colors available to you, but you have to collect them in store. And when you do that, a store assistant, a store associate, or a colleague, or whatever you might call them, will then have an opportunity to engage with you and basically prevent you from taking stuff away that just isn't going to fit you. So they can then optimize the sale. And it makes better use of their staff, and reduces the returns cost, the returns handling cost. I didn't quite understand what that slide was about, what this motherboard is, but what you find, telecoms companies are looking to provide a lot of extra services. You already get it. It used to be you couldn't get to the internet through a mobile provider without using their services. You had to use the Vodafone portal to get to the internet. So they got, let's say, disintermediated. They had to provide the net neutrality to get to everybody's internet. Now they're looking to find other ways to get some services that are applicable to you at the time, that make sense to you based on your usage or predicted usage? You'll see a lot of information coming out from, there's a lot of interest in the data that's coming from renewable energy sources. Pros and cons. Does it work? Does it work efficiently? Is it the best way of doing things? So you can get better and more optimal efficiencies out of the systems if you combine it with other information, so large-scale data about weather, real-time, very localized data to do with weather can tell you whether you should be realigning your wind farms, turning off the turbines, because there's power required to turn off the turbine, there's power required to turn it out, so you actually lose some of the energy you've generated by turning them off. So if you can avoid it, because you know there's only a small squall coming in, there's a minor shift in wind, then you can have better and more continuous generation. And that will also help drive where you place things and where we place energy storage capabilities. Once we have them, we have things like liquid metal battery storage capabilities, where are you going to put them to get optimal capture and playback of the stored energy? More of the same. So the big thing that's happening in industry, which when you're looking at the analytics side of things, is what's changing in the roles of people who are going to make this possible. In the past, what you get is managerial reports that were performance related. And that churn out on a two-weekly basis, a weekly basis. If it's retail, it'd be like the Monday morning review. How did things go last week? What are we going to do different this week? And that's changing to accommodate a whole load of different roles now, where everybody wants the information. They want it right now. They want to know what's happening situationally in their business. We get organizations in car manufacturing that have war rooms, which are large-scale, real-time data visualizations, massive dashboards that show current political situations in any of their target markets, commodity prices to do with the supply chain for materials, leather, plastics, aluminium, ore, even cost of energy. All of those things can have a material effect on the ability for a car manufacturer to sell into a particular market. Shipping costs, piracy on their shipping routes is going up or down. What do they have to do to plan and manage around that risk? But lots more situational awareness. The key one that's coming out of it is a role for chief data officer. There was no role before around it. It was all about particular roles being interested in the output from a data analysis. Now there's a chief data officer whose role is to create those analyses and treat it as a business area. So again, these will be in the deck, but the main things we're looking here for are what is it that is stopping people from getting insight. Usually it's because you can't get the analysis, you can't get to the data. The institutions don't have a way of creating the systems quickly enough. So you don't trust them to do it for you. The cost of doing the work means that nobody wants to invest in it because they haven't seen the potential benefits. So part of our message to the market is there has to be a benefit for it. You have to be able to see it to make sure you can invest in it. And there's an external word that has been added in here, which is leverage the latest open technologies. In the past, you would have seen people like IBM say leveraging the best technologies, which of course would imply ours. Microsoft would say the same, Oracle would say the same. What we're beginning to see is an acceptance that really it's open technologies that are going to drive this change quickly. The whole idea of being able to do analytics is that you can make quick decisions, make changes in your market, changes in the way you run your business, your operation, your life. If you can't then make the products that produce that information change quickly, you would switch to other products. The open technology means that there's a continuous evolution going on. What we saw a couple of years ago was the adoption of cloud was slow, patchy, treated as it was as if it was a different thing, a different part of your business. So the information that you would need to be able to do full-scale commercial analytics was split between what you had in the cloud and what you had in the enterprise. We talked last time about systems of record and systems of engagement. Systems of record tended to be hidden away in your enterprise, managed by the IT department, managed by maybe a data management group, but they weren't shared out to the new systems of engagement, which meant you got siloed data. Even within your organization, you got siloed data because it was all being like very well protected. So being able to access the data or create your own little pool of data. Used to work in reinsurance, and what that meant was that there were actuaries that would have their own data models for particular risk, for hurricane risk. They would have three or four workstations under their desk, and they would run all their models every 3 or 4 months, because it took a long time for the models to run, and they would get an output. But they couldn't share what their data was, they could only share the output. So if they left, or their machines died, we basically lost their data. Being able to put it into the cloud and giving them the ability to run at the scale that they wanted, the reason they had four machines was it wouldn't run on a single workstation. Putting it onto a cloud system, and they could run it whenever they wanted, and their data wasn't lost. Their models weren't lost. They could be passed on to or shared and improved by other actuaries. So what we're looking to do is drive in-time actions. So the more information you can get real-time, having already modeled data that you've had from the past, you can work out what past activities looked like, what the performance was like, make changes to the models and see how they're moving forward. The ability to connect to the proper data but make sure that it's protected. So that's what you've seen in the Bluemix stuff about enterprise integration, API gateways and so on as a way to get back into what was traditionally siloed data. And some of that data siloed within organizations may still stay siloed because of where they are jurisdictionally and so on. So within the company itself, you can't have links between the data pipes, but you can export them into a cloud environment and then the data can be manipulated as a whole there. Looking at reducing the cost, obviously, because the more you can put into someone else's infrastructure and have an economy of scale, the much more likely is you're going to get cheaper infrastructure to run it on, so you can try things that are, would it traditionally be very expensive to just even start modeling. And leveraging those open technologies. So when we look at a company we bought 4 years ago, a company called SPSS. Anybody familiar with SPSS, statistical modeling packages? A couple of you. It was really big in the 90s, lots of universities. Biosciences used it a lot. SPSS was seeded into academic institutions worldwide. And everybody liked what it did, generally hated how you did it. It was not the most pretty of tools to use. But what's happened over the last few years, it's improved an awful lot, has an awful lot of feeds to data sources. IBM acquired it, and over the last 2 or 3 years has spent time building in support for R. So you can now use the R modeling system to feed it into an SPSS system. We use SPSS to generate R models and export is that you can start off with open source, and then when you need to get to scale and be able to put in compliance reporting tools and things to show why you did certain things, you can show that the model was run in an enterprise stack, you can bring it into an SPSS environment. Lots of things that are in this platform now to make it up, because as we've gone along, there's the area that we traditionally didn't do in most analytics was content analytics. Almost all of it was structured. So you'd have data management, you'd have structured data, data warehousing, all of which is tables essentially. So SQL oriented relational database management systems. If you put it in a spreadsheet, or you put it in a set of tables in a database, most organizations can handle it. When it came to unstructured data, so document analysis, variable data that came from numerous sources but needed all to be collected under case management systems. So CRM is a great source of variable data. Lots of things you want to attach to an individual. And that could change rapidly as new organizations came along and new modes of business came along. You would be collecting different data for the same person. You might be collecting data from different channels. And there's a drive to minimize the amount of time that somebody in a corporation, a business, needs to talk to their customers. So you use different channels, mobile devices, web pages, online chatbots to let me guide you through this sale kind of activity. All of that still needs to go into a CRM system. Otherwise, you're not capturing all the contact touch points with customers. So that goes into content as opposed to tables, and that content needs to be analyzed so you can work out how does it relate to the progress of that customer. Are they a churn risk if you're a utility company where lots of people sell the same thing and there's only really a certain amount of customer loyalty? What is it that you can predict from customer interactions that means that they're at risk of moving to somebody else? What can you do to now predict that and offset the risk? So offer them a drop in tariff, offer them an insurance package on their boiler system as part of their existing tariff or for a small markup to help them stay with you. So lots of information that we're now looking at bringing in this real time. The real time data, the big data stuff. You can do streaming analytics, but you have to have a model to know what it is you're looking at. So the tools that you'll see in a few minutes are about how do you capture that first model. You take a large corpus of data if you can, and then have a model that gives you a clue as to what it is you've been looking for in streaming analytics. Prescriptive analytics is more about when this happens, I would like you to do this. So we looked at that and we'll revisit again, which is certain conditions, when they arise, I need to take immediate action. I know that. And I can set up systems to implement. So look at the analytics capabilities within the cloud platform you've already played with. Right. So I missed out a whole load of IBM-oriented slides here, but there's one key one here: is the Big Data University. Large chunk of IBM has been moving towards enablement of big data, but particularly around the analysis and analytics of any kind of data form, whether it was big data or just corporate tables, performance management tools. And we realized that most people hadn't really got a clue about what that meant within IBM. And IBM's at the time was between a third and half a million employees worldwide. So getting people in IBM to talk to the world about what analytics was about was kind of difficult. So we set up a thing called the Big Data University, which allows anyone within IBM to get some background on what analysis was, data management was, what governance is around. And that's now public. So there's a Big Data University website. around the called bigdatauniversity.com, and you can sign up for free. It doesn't use your IBM ID, I'm afraid. It uses LinkedIn, Facebook. Now, that in itself gives you clues what's going on. You sign up with a Yahoo account, a Facebook account, a LinkedIn account, a Twitter account. That immediately, and I suspect will be used to get access to your social graph. So who are you and why are you coming in to sign up for Big Data University? What kind of connections do you have? What is it that makes you particularly interested as opposed to these other people that have signed up? So there's more to the just what's your email address and who are you? Using those methods to authenticate, give a lot of information away automatically. So any organization that's asking you to sign up with social media credentials is looking for you as an individual, looking for your information, not just an identity. It's about you as a person. But it's all on here. I'll show you how to get onto that. We've got lots of developer work stuff, which relates to the Bluemix and Watson and the general analytics systems. And then you get the IBM training is the paid for stuff. What you can do is get credits. You might be interested in badges. Again, that's a kind of social media thing. That's one of the reasons that we do with the Big Data University is to publish badges into your social media. So if you're using LinkedIn, we can publish things into LinkedIn that says, this person has now completed a course in data governance, in data discovery, in outcome management, whatever it might be. And that gives you an extra skill that you can highlight within LinkedIn if that's your bag.
So the message is you guys need to use your LinkedIn account rather than your Facebook account.
Yeah, don't. I know it's been recorded, but I would not use my Facebook account for anything that's a corporate thing that says, hey, you can sign up here for free, you don't need to create a new ID, just give us your Facebook account. It's too much information for them to then decide which bits they want. They're going to have to filter it. And the traditional model in corporations, when you set up a new system, is what will we collect? What data will we collect? What will we log? So that we can work out what's happening. And the default position is, we'll log everything, and then we'll figure it out later, and then we'll purge and prune it.
Much chance of that bit.
For many decades, what that meant was they collected so much data they couldn't use it and had to keep throwing it away, because you run out of disk space, it was too expensive. Then people figured out that if you were keeping it, you then had to back it up. So there are libraries and industrial estates full of tapes of backups and so that nobody ever looked at. Nobody ever even knew it was there and has to now be kept for 7 years, 12 years. Insurance companies, they have to keep it for 10 years after the last incident on an insurance policy, for example. So if you've got life insurance policy, they're going to keep your data. Say you die at 18, they have to keep it till whatever your 90th birthday was. And they've no idea what it is, and they have never looked at it. So don't give them any more, because at some point they'll get enough space and enough compute power to go and harvest it up. Yeah. So the big thing that came out of all of that was we had the systems of record, which we talked about, this is the data that was already stored in silos being kept in databases. The systems of engagement, that's new models of delivery of interaction with data, mobile, web, wall-mounted touchscreens, whatever they might be. And between the two is this systems of insight. Again, it's IBM, well, it's industry marketing terminology, but it helps us to break down what we already had, what we want to get to, and what sits in the middle to make that happen. So the what sits in the middle bit is what we'll go through just now. Okay. Any questions? Okay. It's like I've got home now.
No.
So let me hook some stuff up. Has anybody got any questions? Where's that?
When will we be able to log into Bluemix?
So
we've got to guess.
That means that your trial accounts have all expired now, have they?
Yeah.
Okay. So the promo code thing got identified yesterday. So predictive analytics would have helped this an awful lot, right? You would have hoped. One might have hoped that the system that was recording the promo code would also be logging the fact that when people were putting in the promo codes, it was rejecting them. And you would have a rule that said, if we get more than a few promo code rejections, maybe there's a problem and we should go investigate it. That hasn't happened. So it's been reliant on people calling up and saying, I can't use my promo code. Now, you don't know who to call about it. The easy way that is also not particularly obvious is to go send an email to id@bluemix.net and say, I've just tried to register my promo code and I now can't get it. That would have swamped the ID of Bluemix system, but at least then they would have created a whole lot of incidents, and the incidents could then have been lumped together and thought, oh, there's a big issue here, and we can do root cause analysis, problems to do with the promo code system, and had it fixed. But most people, like yourselves, have gone, I'll try again later. So it's not produced the events, and it's also not resulted in incidents being reported. So it's being worked on. As soon as we know, I'll let Richard know and he can pass it on. But I take it that means that today you can't, I can't get you to log in and do anything on your Bluemix account unless you stick a credit card in, which I know one of you has at least. So we can all share your account. So yeah, it'll be fixed as soon as we can do it. I know there was an awful lot of work done over this weekend, and it was unfortunate that this weekend was your kind of month anniversary when you were all going to time out. They did a bunch of changes on Saturday to the European system, and then over Sunday night, Monday, and a little bit of Tuesday, they did some more things to the identity management system and all of the runtimes in the Bluemix core system in Dallas. And it would appear that as soon as they started doing that, promo codes didn't work. There were a number of things not working over the weekend. So it may be, I mean, everything's supposed to be fixed now. I got a message on the status, which I'll show you. If I get the status board up.
First thing I'll do is show you this thing. So
bigdatauniversity.com, worth having a look.
I get to see.
So anybody in the world can do this. You don't have to be signed up to Bluemix. This will tell you the status of all the things that are going on. And since we last spoke, there's a new system that's come up in Sydney, Australia. So anybody that's in Asia Pacific area might find it quicker to log into the system in Sydney, assuming you can get in. What you'll find is that the runtimes are all the same, but some of the services are not all there yet.
Is that a system that's actually located in Sydney, or is it just
in America? Actually in Sydney.
Okay.
Yeah, and there will be more coming. So the Sydney one was the first one to go kind of to the Asia Pac area to cover the network latency stuff.
Mentioned
So
salary days.
Guys.
Over on the right hand side. There's a ticker that runs that tells you what's going on, what activities are going on, and the planned maintenance. We talked about this being an agile platform and being developed in an agile way as well. When they talk about planned maintenance, you might get 1 or 2 days notice that there's going to be a disruption. It's not like what's the plan for the next month, but it's what's the plan for the next day or two. And you can see that there was a maintenance scheduled for 1 o'clock in the morning London time on Monday morning for all of the North American systems. And when that ran, it was a 24-hour outage, but it lasted until 1 o'clock yesterday. So they had some problems, they had some issues. And part of the promo code thing means that it wouldn't have been looked at least today. So it's being looked at today. I would hope it's fixed by the end of the week at the very latest, and then we'll get the promo code reactivated.
At UTC, there's GMT, isn't it, which we're on now.
That's true.
Yeah.
The error codes that you were getting when you put in the promo stuff, was it saying that it wasn't recognized, or was it rejecting them?
It was invalid.
Yeah.
Invalid.
Promo code would not be applied.
Yeah, that's what it's...
It could be applied. Yeah.
It could not be applied, yeah. That's what it's saying now.
Alright. It's progress. So the first one, if it's invalid, that means that it wasn't able to find it, which probably means that the system with the database that has all the promo codes wasn't alive in the right place at the right time. Saying it can't be applied now is to do with some of the identity management stuff, because over on a bit further back, there was some stuff to do with sign-on issues, which are to do with account management. And your prior promo codes are applied to your accounts. So there was an issue around inability to log in over the last day or two for some people.
Have you tried doing it today, folks, or is it just now rejecting it already used?
Yeah. I've just got using my work email address and signed up.
Yeah.
So I've just got 30 extra days on that. That's the only way.
Okay. Yeah. So, and that is the kind of pragmatic workaround. If you want to keep working with Bluemix, use another email address. Get another 30 days. Because of that, and the fact that I can tell you that as a standard workaround, the model is changing. So after Christmas, there will be a different way of doing this. And you won't have to go through this pain or feel like you're gaming the system and getting an extra 30 days. We'll stop on that and make it very straightforward. And as far as I can understand it, is once you've signed up, there's a kind of freemium version that you'll be able to use all the time. Some services you won't be able to use because there'll be a payment-oriented model for it. But the idea is that the bulk of the services will have a free level, and some bits that will always be free.
Are there plans in place just out of sheer interest to stop people from making new accounts and just getting unlimited usage out in the future?
Well, that's what I'm saying. The incentive for doing that will go away because you'll get basically unlimited use of the free stuff. And then if you need to detect something else, then so what we won't be able to detect, unless we make you sign up with your Facebook account or your LinkedIn account, is we won't be able to detect that you create two unlimited freemium accounts. Unless we run something called a global name recognition.
A what recognition?
A global name recognition, which is an analytics tool that we have, which can go through and is used by police forces, insurance companies, that goes through and will look for what's called a golden nominal records, where they look for the characteristics and attributes of an individual and say, when this individual's name comes up, it's actually the same individual as this name. So you'll see that usually in law enforcement, but quite common in insurance and banking, where they're looking for people who are trying to hide money, doing money laundering, and insurance where there's people moving around and trying to find different policies by changing their apparent history. So there's a thing called GNR, it's Global Name Recognition. And it will do name recognition for Western names as well as Arab names, Muslim names, where it'll look for all the different kinds of combinations and spellings to see if you can get a commonality. And so there you'll find that's being used quite a bit at the moment to do any of the kind of refugee identification. I don't think we use that for signing up for Bluemix, but if it turned out lots of people were apparently using the freemium accounts across lots of different jurisdictions, then they might. There's no current incentive for us to do that, because what we're looking for is people to sign up and use the system. Lots of idle accounts really don't help us. So anytime you want to find out what Bluemix is up to, look for status. And there's a status for AU-SYD is the Sydney one. So we're part of the European area, Sydney is part of the Australian area, and the NG is a global thing. It's like the same naming conventions were used by the IETF to come up with .com being basically North America originally. But that's, you can pick up a state, if the status server in one of the regions is down, a different one, and it'll tell you why it thinks the status page might be off for the other reasons. It's also a way to see which services are coming. So one of the ones that I can show you today is Hadoop, analytics for Apache Hadoop. You can use that from your Node-RED environment. There's an HDFS, so Hadoop data store. Analytics for Hadoop, but it only works in the North American segment, so North America, UK, and Sydney. So it's not in the UK. You won't be able to add to it. If you create an application in North America, in the NG, US South area, then you can use Hadoop. And then there's a whole stuff that management console and so on. So do a quick scan of that. Apache Spark is being introduced into the North American system first. So using Spark for Spark clustering for analytics. I don't pretend to know anything about that. I don't pretend to know very much about Hadoop either, but certainly for Spark, if you want to play with it, you have to go into the US system to do it. Other things that are coming.
Spark is essentially a new operating system that's really designed for massive data manipulation. Yeah. Streaming data and all that sort of stuff.
So it's a clustered approach. It's similar to what Hadoop did and MapReduce, but it basically bypasses how MapReduce works. IBM has said that we've dedicated 1,000 developers. So it's open source platform, managed by Apache, but IBM is throwing in 1,000 developers to work on expanding it and implementing it across generic platforms, but also on the IBM platforms. So it'll be on the open power systems, it'll be on mainframe, Z systems.
It's mentioned a lot in the keynote addresses at IBM Insight in Vegas a couple of weeks, 3 weeks ago. It mentioned more than Hadoop was.
Yeah. Hadoop seems to be kind of waning in popularity, and Spark is definitely on the ascendant, but each of these have been open technologies that were developed for particular times and capabilities. So Hadoop was built where you had lots of small systems you needed to spread the stuff around. With cloud systems, actually the economics change and you become able to deliver large-scale vertical systems as well as mass data storage.
But also Hadoop was more structured so that you poured the data into it and then fed the data out to your processing from Hadoop. And it was very difficult to get the results of your analytics back into Hadoop in real time. That was always been one of the big problems with SAS with Hadoop is getting the stuff back in there. It's sort of a one-way feed.
The other one, their big insight, is our stream analytics product, which we make available on Bluemix. There's a big analytics for Hadoop, and there's a big analytics for the Hadoop data file server, and there will be one for Spark as well. You can see again, that's only available in North America, which tells you that our data large-scale data processing cluster is in the North American data centers at the moment. Again, a thing about big data is where you process that data might be constrained by your local jurisdictions. So when you send data off to be processed in a Spark cluster, you're sending the information into North America. If you've got a local law that says you can't do that, then you can't use that service. Okay. So other ones we've got, DataWorks is a service which does data discovery. So you can load data in, it will explore the data, it's a kind of workbench for data load. Available in the UK and in North America. Our Dialogue is a new service that's just been implemented since we last chatted. So when you looked at Watson, some of the Watson services, there was a thing called the Watson question and answer Q&A tool, which was based off essentially a large troll of Wikipedia and other material, but it was fairly static. You could only really get it to answer questions for which it had already been fed and trained around a bunch of data. So it's kind of the residual stuff from the Jeopardy quiz. That has been sunset, so that Q&A was a beta tool. It's been sunset and has been replaced by the Dialogue tool, which you can train. But I have not had an opportunity to try this yet, but it's available to you whenever you can get on your Bluemix account. You can now bring up a Dialogue service and you can start training it in the right kind of answers. So you can use it for the kind of things that you might do with an interactive voice response unit, an IVR, where you would have a script. So you know when you call a help desk and you say, I have a problem, I know very specifically what the problem might be, and they say, have you tried turning it off and on? Have you done these things? And they go through a very rigid diagnostic script. Dialogue will let you create those scripts and then create a kind of dynamic branching that says when the script needs to be adjusted because of a circumstance, you can put that in. So it's not quite the same as a Q&A, but it's going to be more guided. And there's a demo which I'll show you.
Geospatial.
Geospatial analytics is, so geocoding is handy if you're going to do geospatial, but geocoding is only available in the US. It's Whitney Bowes provides that in North America. Geospatial analytics will let you do regional analytics. It let you work out where things are in relation to each other, those kinds of things.
Well, so if you've got latitude, longitude, or something like that, or
lat-long, yeah. So the geocoding one takes things like postcodes, zip codes, and converts them into approximate lat-longs, or takes a lat-long and converts it into a zip code. It doesn't do it for UK postcodes. It doesn't work in Ireland because they don't have them. So the reason it's only in North America is because the North American, so US and Canada, have zip codes that match or can be matched to
lat-longs. It's because our own postcode here is precise.
Yeah. Yes, because it's a route rather than a place.
Yeah, so it locates six houses basically on one side of the road.
So you see new things have come in. So there's insights for Twitter, which we'll have a quick look at, and some of the language translation things have been added recently. We'll go over those in a little bit. Natural language classifier is a secondary bit that's come out of the Q&A. So this is for when you have text or you've done speech to text and you want to figure out, at least at the first level, what kind of piece of information this is. So it's first level content analytics. Allow you to classify that. Is it a question? If it's about weather, is it about conditions or temperature or air pressure, those kinds of things. So it's not a detailed breakdown, but it's been split out of the Q&A system. So it's the bit that lets you guide if you've got different search criteria or search strategies within your data, you can use the classifier to tell you where to go, which silo to go to, essentially, to speed up your search algorithms. Presence Insights is here for, that's to do with video analytics, essentially. It's where were these people spotted and how are they moving? That needs an awful lot of setup. So you need to have registered video feeds, camera feeds. You've got to know the locations and all that stuff. But it's a long project if you want to get that going, but it's used for things like shopping malls and transport systems to link through consumer journey activities. Q&A is in here, but it's being deprecated and will go away in 3 or 4 days. So at the end of the weekend, end of this week, you won't be able to get a new Q&A service activated. And then the speech text has had some extra bits added. So you can now send stream data as well as WAV files, and you can now send also OGG encoded data. Text to speech has had a few extra languages and voices added. So you can choose a variety of male and female voices in different languages. So when we talk about analytics, the Watson services you see in Bluemix are examples of applied analytics. So when we're doing speech to text, it can do real-time speech to text, which is essentially transcription. What you're saying, it recognizes it and tells you what it thought it was. If you do a pause-oriented translation, so it gets time to revisit what it's translating, it can basically repair it. So if you ever watched the subtitles on the news when the TV sounds turned off in the public areas, you could see it going back and overwriting some of the wording. Or actually, sometimes you'll just see the word that it got wrong appearing somewhere later on. With the Watson speech to text, it can go back and revisit what it's doing as it learns how you're saying things and can improve its recognition. So it's applied analytics that we're seeing here. The visual recognition, I think we did that. I did this in Aston last weekend, and we got 2 weekends ago. We got some very strange things coming out, but it was enough to show that it's applied analytics. That will come with a trainable version as well. That's on the way. So you can load it up with lots of your own images. So things like if you wanted to have a way of recognizing all your friends with your eyes shut, if you were wandering around, you could have a camera. It's much easier to train things to say, I've got a very small domain to recognize against. Can you spot these? As opposed to saying, here's everybody can possibly be, who do you think it might be? So training's much easier that way. And then the last one, is the IoT real-time insights. And that has allegedly been improved in the last month. When I was here last time, didn't get into because it's complicated to set up, but it's a bit easier to set up, so with a bit of luck I'll set it up so you can see it. It had a limitation where the only thing you could do was send emails, which was kind of useless, because the whole idea of real-time insights is that you should be able to trigger a real-time response to a condition that you've detected. not send an email that goes to somewhere that then is picked up by somebody on their phone, or takes us back to the days of the 80s and 90s of mail-in databases. So that's now been improved. We can do real-time API invocations and SMS messaging, I think. So we'll have a look at that. Okay. So I'm going to be demoing rather than you being able to log in and do your own here, because I'll just set you up. First one, though, I want to show you was the What's Analytics tool. And that is over here. Bear with me a sec while I get it over onto the screen. So you can go to watsonanalytics.com, you can go to watson ibm.com/analytics, and eventually it will jump you around until you get to the IBM Watson Analytics. Need to shrink the screen down a bit again. So Watson Analytics has three options available to you. You can get a free version, which lets you do insights, essentially, is what Richard had some experience of. What used to be Cognos Insight is now Watson Analytics free edition, where you can load up a spreadsheet and then have it visualize the data for you. So it'll interrogate the data in the spreadsheet as a CSV file and say, okay, here's a number of relationships that I can see already just because of the way that the data is presented to me. How would you like to see that? And one of the experiences that I mentioned is when people talk about analysis or analytics of data, very often the first stage what they're looking for is visualization. First stage analytics is visualize it. Show me a way of looking at it that I can use to figure out what it's telling me. So the free edition lets you take any arbitrary spreadsheet up to, I think it's 100,000 rows. If you do the Big Data University, there is a sample for data called sentiment analysis. When you load it up, it fails to load because it's got 105,000 rows in it. So somebody here has made it clever enough that you can't load it into the personal edition. So since it's all arbitrary data, if you want to make it work, just go and hack out 10,000 rows and throw them away. But if you're using the free edition, it won't work. There is a trial, free trial on the personal edition, I think. When you sign up for the personal edition, you get a free trial for 30 days again. That lets you do a little bit more. You can get the regular spreadsheet type data, CSV data, but you can also then hook into Twitter. So the arrangement we have with Twitter means we get all of the enhanced data feeds. So every Twitter message is then tagged with where the author's home location is, the time of day, which country, all that stuff. So the location data is broken down into country, city, region information. So you can then do location-based visual analysis.
Based around the home location, not on where they happen to be today.
So when the first name storm last week came up, first big storm being called a big gale, which was brilliant. I looked to see where is that being tweeted about, and not surprisingly, the highest percentage of people tweeting about Abigail were as the UK. Well, there were people in Kenya, there were people in Australia, New Zealand, obviously, who were saying, "Oh, everybody stay safe in the UK." There were people in South America. We were tweeting about it, but it came up immediately as a visualization. So I'll show you that. So you can sign up for these. Off you go.
Does the first edition have a few more rows capability, or?
The first edition has extended storage. Yes.
Yeah.
So it's more storage.
Oh, right.
That's it. So and then the professional one is all the same stuff, but you get to use Cognos reports and you get to share them. Everything else is kind of personal, it's your space. If you wanted to share across an organization, then you need the professional edition. And you can see the pricing.
I got a million.
So instead of 100,000 rows, you can use a million rows. 10 million rows if you're a professional. And you're limited to how many columns you can bring in if you're using the personal edition. 50 columns is a fair amount of data.
Yeah.
If you're looking at tweet data or sensor data, you can easily get within 50 columns. And then you can nice big and wide columns. You get 500 meg to start with. If you go with the free version, then you go to 2 gig.
And we, with our promo codes, we get the middle column, effectively, do we?
I don't know.
Oh.
We'll get to see what happens when your promo code comes up. I think you mentioned this, because I'm an IBMer, I get trial versions of things that are set up for me using my internal IBM ID and my equivalent IBM ID, which is what you created to get onto Bluemix. Quite often, there's a clash with those settings. So when I tried to set up a personal edition and said, this is useless, I can't even do the first example in the Big Data University, I need the personal edition to be able to at least talk to folk like yourselves. They couldn't set it up for me, so they had to throw it all away. So I have the professional version. So when you see things that I'm doing, it's with the professional tool. The capabilities are all the same, it's just that I would be able to share them and I could get a little bit loads more data. But the tooling is essentially the same. And, I don't know what the promo codes give you with respect to what's in analytics. Sign in and you can see it in some predictive things, you can do data exploration, you can assemble some flows for data analysis, and you can do the refinement, so you can filter, you can enhance the data as you go. Get far enough down. This reads a bit chunky at the moment with this. Go over here. So with the personal edition, you can't create data connections. But with the free version, you can't create data connections. With the personal edition, you can, which means you can point it back to data that you created in Bluemix, which is the good bit, right? So if you wanted to do a quick visualization of data that you're collecting and storing in a Bluemix platform. Like from Node-RED, yes. If you can get it into one of the supported databases. I think it's not showing things on the bottom of the screen. Which is, there we go. Create new connection. Those are the, apart from that Cognos server, you can't, and Oracle, you won't be able to get to those without getting the professional edition. But you can connect to an SQL database in Bluemix. You can talk to DB2. That's one of the exercises on the Big Data University is DB2. You can do the same exercise by pointing it to SQL database on Bluemix. And MySQL, the IBM-DB is a Bluemix service for data warehousing. If you want to connect a UN to it, you have to give it the server name, the port name, the database name. Currently, it doesn't have a way of saying, I can see all of the SQL services that you have. Which one do you want to import? So you have to flip backwards and forwards from the Bluemix service definition, and it'll tell you the ports to connect to. So I think, so this one will tell you, you'll have to get the host name, you have to get the port number, it's usually 50,000 if it's DB2, SQLDB, and then there's an identity that goes with that, which is the connection definition. So you've got a database instance that's yours, you have to tell it which one is your database, because you can have a number of them that you wanted to work with, and then give it user ID and password. This one I pointed to the database that is provided with the Java example. It's called the Viden framework boilerplate on Bluemix, and it creates a little CRM database. I'll come out there and get back to welcome. Get far enough down the screen. Go into the personal section. Here's my Twitter data. This was loaded last week, but Anna, as you said, to get the first set of data, you've got to go and load it up from somewhere. So this one came in from the Twitter feed. Since it knows it's Twitter data, it knows what the metadata is around Twitter feeds, because we've built the link with Twitter to do this. I can do some very quick, so without me doing anything around the data other than just saying this is the hashtag I want to bring in. It's looked at all the data that's available and said, okay, here's some relationships you might be interested in visualizing. So it's looking for the author's names. So not a very useful one, but it's a relationship that is hidden in the data. Kind of moronic one, but see if we can get a different one. Scroll off to this side of the screen again. Click in, come on. Go back. Should be scrolling at the side, but I can't see the scroll mark. Sorry, this is just I'll have to shrink it down a bit. Now I can see that thing. The number of tweets per hour. So the sentiment, one of the Watson services that you can invoke is sentiment analysis. So it's doing that automatically on the data for everybody that's tweeting about whatever Abigail was at the time. So the Abigail that was, I did this, the hashtag for, doesn't necessarily mean it's the UK storm. It could be just anybody who happened to use the Abigail hashtag. So it will give you an idea of the information in here. So there's an awful lot of tweets happening between 12 and 1 o'clock. And so lots of people at lunchtime who heard about the weather forecast started tweeting. Some there's very very little content to say whether it's positive or negative, just saying it is happening. Others were saying, oh, that's a good thing, or it's negative. So not wanting the negative stuff. So without you having to do anything at all, you can get kind of a visual cue from the data without having to formulate any new queries. It's going to try and give you some representation out of the box. You'll see the same if you use something like Tableau, which again does I think it's a 30-day free trial. Tableau Online has similar tools. It's also free, but then you have to pay for it. So if you're using Bluemix, then this is the gives you the same and more capabilities, but can attach to your Bluemix data too. So if you wanted to create a new one, sit down again, sorry. Wanted to go back and create a new query. So if I wanted to upload some data, so here's my data sources in here. So you can bring in stuff from OneDrive, from Box and Dropbox. It's going to be expecting some kind of structured data there. If it's looking, it'll be looking for a CSV file. But you can also bring things in from a local file, just upload. I've got a database here, which has some customer data. It'll do a date. Nothing clever about this, it'll go off and do a metadata query on that database. We'll do a little preview of the data. Do a quick query. So I'll upload the data now. Because of the way this works, you can't really visualize data until you've got some. So it goes off and creates a batch of data to start from. And once you've got that data, you can then start to build prediction models. So that's finished.
I haven't figured out yet what the quality means, but I'm thinking that that's to do with
how the data looks. So does it have 100% consistency across its columns and things? Is all the data complete? Do they have oddities in some of the rows, that kind of stuff? But without doing too much in here, it's already figured out that there's some relationships within the data. The number of last names in a particular place with a birth date. Some of these relationships will be meaningless, but it will visualize them for you anyway. So what's the relationship between the number of last names and that? Let's have a look and see what that produces. So not very useful. You get some clustering of information that relates to some unknown thing. But it's created a visualization for you, and you can then figure out if that made more sense than say the Twitter visualization of sentiment over time. That was maybe more meaningful. But you get to see the data quickly without you having to go off and create a query and look at tables of data and figure out whether it's meaningful or not. You can see that makes no sense for any useful analysis. So you can point to this at any data you like within the Bluemix SQL structure. It doesn't. It can currently use the -db. -db is an SQL database view, but it you can populate it from a cloud and database. But you have to go through that intermediate stage of loading cloud and data into the -db. The -db can aggregate data from lots of different data sources first. So you create a data warehouse tool, and then use Watson Analytics to do the visualization. Thank you.
If you look on the Big Data University. Watson. The one to jump into would be Watson Analytics Fundamentals. We're getting going. It talks about data series, about data refinement, exploring the data, and then adding predictions onto what you've picked up. So it takes you through the cycle of collect your data, do some analysis, predict, and then revisit your data. So come up with a hypothesis, implement change, and then revisit. You don't need to know anything about big data to do this. You don't need to know anything about the tools. It's basically, if you can get hold of some data, you can visualize it.
Yes.
And so that, guys, gives you a clue to how you could do. So that gives you a clue that if you want to use a reasonable sized amount of data, you know, sort of 30 to 100,000 rows of data for your assignment, you can build it in through here quite easily. Just do the Watson Analytics Fundamentals course, learn how to do it, and then acquire the right size of data set. Intelligently think about the sort of patterns that you could use to come up with some insights, and bingo.
Yeah. Give you an idea of the duration of these things. So we'll say do the course. You're looking at little 10 to 15 minute segments to do stuff. It's not really that demanding. And some of it you can say, all right, I know what's going to happen here. And it just takes you through the screens. But it will guide you through how to get stuff going in Watson Analytics, get the visualization work going, and then take you into the exploration. And then a predicting series data from it. So I'm not going to take you through that. I'm assuming
that you will just use the Big Data University course.
To get a quick and easy access to Watson Analytics, and learn how to use it quickly with enough and use your own source of data. This is great. What you've been looking at though is to make it easy for yourselves. Is have an SQL oriented version of your data. So you might have collected it as NoSQL or a big JSON string. For you to be able to process it in Watson Analytics quickly,
mm-hmm.
it needs to be structured.
CSV is minimum.
CSV is a minimum. So if you if you don't get the personal edition, you only get the free edition, then create it as a CSV file, export it through a web page, load it into Watson. There's no quick and easy way to build like a pipeline where you could drive it through, but that's a simple way to get going. So they're 10 to 15 minute sections. You don't have to do them all. If you know what it's going to talk about, or have a quick look and see what the summary is, and you think, oh, I know that bit, or that's not to do with what I'm trying here, then skip past it. When you discover that maybe you should have done it, you can always go back. And it will keep track of where you've been. So you can see which bits you've done. And there's a whole load of other stuff in there that's more to do with other IBM products, or to do with things like Spark, Hadoop, MapReduce, analytics tools. Okay. And I will be doing the course as well. So it's not something that I recommend without actually doing it. That's how I discovered that I needed to have the personal edition to use the demo database.
demo CSV file. Be aware, it won't work with the free version. One of the first exercises, the second exercise is create yourself a connection to DB2. That doesn't work with the free version. You have to have at least personal available to you. Maybe free data set, I think, to start it. So yeah, there's a data set to get going. Which I think I've just downloaded again. And that's your sign up options. So you can create your own username and do your own registration so you don't have to go through the social OAuth based stuff. If you have a LinkedIn one, that's probably the least iniquitous way of doing it, shall we say. Facebook, I would watch out. It's just going to suck in as much of your social graph as it can. Or has the potential to do it. But you can create an account from scratch if you need to. I haven't tried it, so I don't know whether it will link to your IBM ID. I think the idea with this course is that it was not related to IBM specifically, which is why there's an IBM ID link. Which I think it's on 4 times.
Shall we break for coffee there?
I would love a break, yes. It's got warmer and warmer.
It's getting very warm.
So I presume that's to do with humidity as well.
Coffee? Air conditioning doesn't work too well.
Coffee. So, any questions?
Any questions before we have a half hour break, folks?
I need a break.
You need your break.
I need my coffee.